Hello everybody and welcome back to the Texas Podcast. I am your host Gabe and today we're going to be talking about the Battle of Lipantitlan. The Battle of Lipantitlan, also known as the Battle of Nueces Crossing, was fought along the Nueces River on November 4th, 1835 between the Mexican Army and Texan insurgents as part of the Texas Revolution. Fort Lipantitlan was built on the grounds of an old campsite along the west bank of the Nueces River on the Gulf Coast of Texas. The site was first occupied by a nomadic Lipan Apache tribe during their periodic visits. After the Apaches abandoned the area, the campground was often used by missionaries, military units, and traders making their way between Mexico and the Texas settlements. In 1825 or 26, Mexican officials constructed a makeshift fort named Lipantitlan after the Lipan Apaches at the campsite. According to Texan John J. Lynn, the fort was a single embankment of earth lined within by fence rails to hold the dirt in place, and would have answered tolerably well perhaps for a second-rate hog pen. The embankment was surrounded by a large ditch. Just outside the ditch lay adobe and wooden huts for the officers and their families. The Texas Revolution officially began on October 2nd at the Battle of Gonzales. Within days, Texan insurgents seized Presidio La Bahia located at Goliad. 20 Mexican soldiers escaped and briefly took refuge at Capano and Refugio. Those garrisons soon abandoned their posts and joined the larger force at Lipantitlan. The Mexican soldiers at Lipantitlan began improving the defenses of their small fort, as they were only remaining garrison on the Texas coast. Fort Lipantitlan was a vital link between the Mexican interior and Bejar, the political center of Texas, which housed coasts and the only other force of Mexican troops in Texas. Captain Philip DeMitt assumed command of the Texans at Presidio La Bahia. In a letter to General Stephen F. Austin dated October 15th, DeMitt proposed an attack on Fort Lipantitlan, whose capture would secure the frontier, provide a vital station for defense, create instability among the Centralists, and encourage Mexican Federalists. Most of the Federalists in San Patricio were afraid of retaliation if they openly defied Santa Anna's Centralist policies. They were also reluctant to hold elections for delegates to the consultation, which would decide whether Texans were fighting for reinstatement of the Constitution of 1824 or for independence from Mexico. Soldiers at Lipantitlan had also imprisoned two of DeMitt's men, John Williams and John Toole, as they tried to deliver missives to the Federalist leaders in San Patricio on October 10th and 11th. DeMitt hoped to free the men after capturing Fort Lipantitlan. On October 20th, James Power, one of the Irish impresarios who helped found San Patricio, learned that the Lipantitlan soldiers had been ordered to retake Presidio La Bahia. 200 cavalry were expected to reinforce the Lipantitlan garrison before the attack, with an additional 200-300 soldiers expected later. Although DeMitt forwarded the intelligence to Austin, he was not given authorization to attack. The delay proved costly to Williams and Toole, who were marched to the Mexican interior beyond the reach of the Texans. According to DeMitt's angry letter to Austin, Toole begged his captors to kill him outright rather than send him on the march, which he believed would result in his death. DeMitt concluded, "This news, after the leniency shown to the prisoners taken here, could not fail to create a lively and a strong excitement. The men under my command are clamorous for retaliation." The furor over the removal of Williams and Toole's likely led DeMitt to take matters into his own hands. On October 31st, he sent a member of his staff, Adjutant Ira Westover, to take 35 men to attack Fort Lipantitlan. A self-appointed advisory committee, John J. Lynn, Major James Kerr, and Power rode along. The three advisors had been elected to the consultation but delayed their departure so that they could participate in the fighting. Rather than riding directly southwest of the fort, Westover traveled southeast to Refugio. This alternate route was likely intended to suggest that the expedition was headed for Capano Bay. An unknown number of men joined the expedition in Refugio. Historian Craig Rohr believes that the expedition grew by at least 20 men, and historian Bill Groneman estimated that Westover's force numbered 60 to 70 men when it reached San Patricio. Meanwhile, the commander of the garrison at Fort Lipantitlan, Captain Nicholas Rodriguez, received orders to harass the Texans at Presidio La Bahia. On October 31st, as Rodriguez and his men neared Goliad, they learned that a Texan force had left the fort earlier that day. The Mexican soldiers immediately retraced their route. They did not encounter any Texan soldiers during their march and arrived on November 1st to find the fort unmolested. Uncertain as to what the Texans intended to do, Rodriguez and the bulk of his garrison turned back towards Goliad to attempt to intercept the Texans. Between 21 and 27 soldiers armed with two cannons remained to defend the fort. Rodriguez expected the Texans to take a direct route. His men patrolled the northern approaches of the fort. Westover's men instead approached from the east, eluding the Mexican patrols. 5 miles from San Patricio, Westover received word that Rodriguez was searching for the Texans. He forced the men to increase their pace. They arrived at San Patricio 30 minutes after sundown on November 3rd. Westover positioned two small groups of men to guard the Nueces River crossings about 70 yards from the fort. As the rest of the Texans prepared for a dawn assault, two San Patricio residents wandered into their camp. Westover arrested one of them, James O'Reilly, for aiding and assisting the enemy. In exchange for his liberty, O'Reilly offered to persuade the Mexican garrison to surrender. Historians have no records of what methods O'Reilly used, but by 11 p.m. the Mexican soldiers had surrendered without a shot fired. They were released immediately as long as they promised not to fight again during the Texas Revolution. The Texans captured the two 4-pounder cannons, 18 muskets, and 3 and 4 pounds of powder. They also released several Texans who had been held prisoner in the fort. The following day, Texans burned the wood huts adjacent to the fort and dismantled the embankments. By 3 p.m., they had rounded up 14 horses and were preparing to bring the cannons back to Goliad. In the meantime, Rodriguez had traveled almost all the way to Goliad. Before he reached Presidio La Bahia, one of his spies arrived with news that the Texans had taken Fort Lipantitlan. Rodriguez and his men, including 10 colonists from San Patricio, marched back to the fort, arriving at about 4 p.m. The Texans used a small canoe to transport men across the Nueces River, and when the Mexican soldiers were sighted, only half of the Texans' force had crossed to the east bank of the river. As the Mexican soldiers attacked, the Texans took cover in a grove of trees. The trees prevented the cavalry from approaching, so Rodriguez's men dismounted and attempted to attack from both sides. The Texan rifles had a much longer range than the Mexican Brown Bess muskets, 200 yards compared to 70 yards. After 30 minutes of fighting, the Mexicans withdrew, leaving behind 8 horses and several wounded men. The only Texan injured was Lieutenant William Bracken, who lost 3 fingers. Texan rifleman A.J. Jones later wrote to Fannin that 3 Mexicans had died with 14 wounded, though historian Stephen Harding believes that 5 Mexicans died with 17 wounded. Jones's letter mentioned that 3 of the wounded were the alcalde, judge, and sheriff of San Patricio. Without draft animals, the Texans had no easy way to transport the artillery. As night approached, a cold rain began to fall, and the men began discouraged. Westover, Lur, Kerr, and Power agreed to throw the artillery in the river rather than continue to struggle with it. The Texans also deposited their cache of captured ammunition and muskets in the river. In their opinion, the supplies were useless. Most Texans spent the night at San Patricio, housed by sympathetic locals. Mexican troops camped outdoors near the battle site. At dawn, Westover agreed to allow the wounded Mexican soldiers to be transported to San Patricio for treatment. The following day, one of the wounded soldiers, Mexican Lieutenant Marcelino Garcia, died. Garcia was a personal friend of Lynn, and the Texans gave him a full burial with honor. Westover sent a message to Rodriguez to request another pleasant meeting. Rodriguez declined the offer and retreated with his remaining men to Matamoros. The departure left only one remaining group of Mexican soldiers in Texas, those under General Cost at Bejar. The Texans now controlled the Gulf Coast, and so all communication between Cost and the Mexican interior must be transferred overland. The long distance involved severe slow the delivery of messages and receipt of supplies and reinforcements. According to Groneman, this likely contributed to Cost's defeat, which expelled the Mexican remaining soldiers from Texas. That is all for today, ladies and gentlemen. I want to thank you all for watching. I hope this video was informational enough for you, and I hope you all enjoyed. I'll see you all in the next one.